Hello students, today I am Dr. Smita Patil, going to speak about the lecture on manifestation of the patriarchy. I teach in Department of Gender and Development Studies. So in this lecture, what I am going to do, let me explain to you the objectives that to understand the background of the gender debates in a deeper manner, to know about the patriarchy, how it operates at the several levels, how it organized in the public and private domain, and to analyze the culture and gender relationship. I would also focus on how patriarchy operates in order to understand caste, community, structural society and the power dynamics. And in order to understand that, I would also cite one of the case studies while speaking about it. So let us understand the gender roles to know about the patriarchy. The men and women are historically placed in the society on the basis of the gender location. Gender relation makes us understand the unequal relationship, and the categories of the gender informed us how they are created through interaction between individuals, communities and their surroundings, and suggests that masculine and feminine roles are not associated with the male and female biological traits, but it weakens the process of socialization. At one level, they are easy to distinguish. Sex refers to the biological differences between male and female bodies, while gender refers to everything else that goes into making us man and woman. And then you would see the social and culture processes, economic and political structures further carries out. Now, to understand this, the classic texts such as Mary Wollstonecraft's, Vindication of the Rights of Women, which she contributed in 1872, at the end of the 18th century in the England. Now, Wollstonecraft reflects upon the notion of the sex in order to discuss the process that went into making women dissimilar from men, which we call today the process of social construction. So Wollstonecraft argued that women were convinced that they are under category of the weaker sex and not having the potential or the capacity as a rational thinker, which is an argument which she actually says that, you know, it's a false category. As the French feminist Simone de Beauvoir, who wrote a classic book, The Second Sex, and it was written in a French language in 1949 and translated into English in 1955, in which she describes that the historical and societal subjugation of the woman. Therefore, the history of the feminist thought, we found that no reason or no distinction between the biological sex or the social gender have been given or explained. However, they keep using the term sex to make their arguments. The earliest formulation came from the writing by the Gail Rubin's, who wrote in 1974, in which she explained what she calls the sex gender system. Now, Rubin analyzes of the woman's operation by making some very plausible claim. Whoever we are, whether we are feminist or against feminist ideas, it is what we think the cause of the woman's operation to be that will determine what kind of society we imagine to be possible in future. Thus, if we believe that men are distinctively aggressive and violent by nature, and there wouldn't be a little scope for change other than to physically alter men's very nature or to get rid of them. But if you know that much of the society and the economic relations within society are playing a role in women's operation, then a different and a more egalitarian future is possible by changing the social and economic structure. Now, on sex and gender, Butler argues, and she offers her criticism, are quite complex and have been evolving in her numerous writings. According to Butler, a common problem in the use of the term sex and gender in the way, for instance, that, you know, Galen Rubin did in 1974 essay, is that is an assumption of the given biological fact of the sex or something fixed in the body, which is then provided meaning by the social gender. To use easy metaphor, it is as though sex is a body like the determination of the sex of the baby, while gender are the clothes that come later. As she asked, Butler asked this and pointed that if indeed feminist and the other scholar believe that biological sex has a very little to do with gender, then why have we proceed with two sexes and two genders, with gender faithfully following sex? Now, the feminist understanding of the sex gender system, which one would understand, it operates not just for the woman but also for the men. This is because the system, in whatever form we understand, it works with establishing binaries, men and women, male and female, masculine and feminine. It is not accidental in the listing of the binaries, whatever I said, masculine, feminine, female, male, men versus women and so on. And the terms men, male, masculine proceed in the terms of woman, female and feminine. Thus, ordering the sex gender have been done or drawn on the basis of the power to set certain kinds of norms, right? So, it is a system that is unequally slanted to one side. So, even when we say that men, much like women, are structured by the operations of the sex gender of the patriarchy, and one of the names by which we know this system, we need to note that this is a system that favors men, right? So, in the contemporary times, social sciences use the category masculine, and it is in a various ways or variety of the ways. It is common to associate power and the violence, as in the cases where war is by definition seen as masculine, with the masculinity. So, this kind of approach assume that the meaning of the masculinity will remain the same universally for all times. And I think when one understands the manifestation of the patriarchy, the masculinity plays a very important role in all aspects of, like, social, culture, economic, whether it is a war, politics, so and so forth. Such an idea is unstable because there are variation in the normative ideas. Ideals of the masculinity in different cultures at a different time. One of the fallouts of this formulation can be seen in the common enough practice of putting down assertive women by suggesting that they are unfeminine or masculine. The reasoning goes like that: if power and assertions are masculine, women who are powerful and assertive are masculine. Thus, lacking in something, their femininity. Another influential approach is to assume that the study of the masculinity is the same as the study of the men. So, this confusion is compounded by the tendency in masculinity research and to uncritically assume that the object of the study of the men is there. This produces a significant confusion. And as Sedgwick says, that the problem is when, and I quote, an inquiry begins with the presupposition that everything pertaining to the men can be classified as a masculine, and everything that can be said about the masculinity pertains in the first place to men. One will have to find out to expand our investigation to include men, women, animals, inmates, object and so on in our understanding of the masculinity. What is available is a strict system of the binaries into which bodies, object, emotion, etc. are classified. Clearly, there are different pressures of conforming to masculinity as with the case of femininity. Even the significance of the distinction between the bodies are culturally determined and put into culturally legible binaries of the masculine and feminine. Another way to put it is to say that all kinds of bodies in the object have to work with the culturally opted binaries of the masculine and feminine order. So, there is no way in which either man or woman exempt from negotiating both masculinity and femininity. And you would see that the productive to keep the definition open so that it can accommodate differences. Thus, narratives of the masculinity takes resources to normative notions of the masculinity as a standpoint to evaluate gender performance also. To put it differently, any performance or the moment of the masculinity implies the norms. Any attempt at studying the discourse of masculinity will have to undertake the primary objective of teasing out the norms and then that underpins it. And to come back to the disjuncture between men and masculinity, it should be asserted that those moments of the unification have to be seen as a contingent and thus needing reaffirmation in the normative templates. Now, feminists argue that the liberalism is based on the structure of patriarchy and growing class relation. Therefore, they describe this conception as a patriarchal liberalism. Freedom of expression is the product of and for example, that you know, sometime that freedom of expression is the product of patriarchy and the you know, the capitalism. That accordingly, the opposition between the public and private sphere reflect the unequal relationship between men and women. This separation more or less had to lead to the subjugation of the woman. Like, for instance, the liberal theory argues that the separation between the two spheres applies to every individual with the same intensity, therefore divides was ignored. On the contrary, the theory of the liberalism sees the subordination of the private realm to the public domain as a consequence of the nature of the individual. And in the mid-70s, a group of socialist feminists sought to be synthesize the Marxist and radical feminist theory into a viable theory of the social reality and especially women's operation. Their effort led to what becomes known as a dual system theory. This followed from the recognition of the significance of the reproduction in understanding not only capitalism but any mode of production. Further, this is called the theoretical reformulation of the Marxism itself. And according to the dual system theory, women's operation arise from two distinct and relatively autonomous system, patriarchal system, system of the male domination, which produces specific gender operation of the woman, and the system of the mode of production, which produces class operation and determines the appropriation of the surplus value of the woman's work. Now, patriarchy in relation with the specific mode of production, say capitalism, produces the concerned phenomenon of the woman's operation in the society. Indeed, a notion of the capitalist patriarchy has been central to the dual system approach theory. How class as a category of the division in our society has a further detrimental effects when one sees from a gender lens. Beside feminist debates on class, we will also look at how women are treated as a reverse army of the labor. What is a feminist perspective on the domestic labor? It is important to look at these ideas within the historical context also. For instance, if we look at that this debate very carefully, one would see that, you know, the ways in which that women contribute in a public and private domain, it's immense. And in order to understand these debates, Sylvia Wolby's formulation, in which she contributed a book in 1991, Theorizing Patriarchy, where Sylvia Wolby talks about the six structures of the patriarchy in a conceptual framework, is the household production, paid work, the state's role, the male violence, sexuality, and the culture. Now, each of them, for instance, that the household production, paid work, the state, the male violence, sexuality, culture, these are the categories in which, when she's talking about how, you know, it evolves around and in and wave together the patriarchal notion in which the subjugation of the woman happens. Now, what Wolby further also argues that such patriarchy changes also over a period of time. So, it is not something which is a stagnant category. How it changes over a period of time, that one has to observe. Now, for instance, when one is talking in Indian context, one has to also see how manifestation of the patriarchy operates in the caste society. You know, I'm setting this example of India here in order to understand the manifestation of the patriarchy. Right. So, caste has been an important factor in formulating the hierarchy in the Indian society. women get located at the lowest rung under each caste, making it pertinent to examine their situation in casteist Indian society. Deals with the definition of caste, what role it plays in controlling women. Caste is a relation to patriarchy and various other aspects relates to caste and gender. Now, caste and politics before and after independence in India, it regulates and how caste is associated with the marriage and honor killing, right? So, caste is defined as an endogamous group. This clearly means that the marriage is central to the composition of the caste. It has been pointed out that caste derives its identity in its difference from another. All of which have to be generationally transmitted for a close distant group to emerge, persist and expand, and the hierarchies of the caste represents a coexistence of inequalities in rituals and you would see in the ritual status, in the law, in the control over the productive resources including labor and access to knowledge. So, the privileges are concern at the top and the disabilities at the bottom, producing a form of institutionalized inequality which goes far beyond more purity and pollution. So, an individual location within the caste system determines not only the material condition of the everyday living but also the experience of the power. And in the manifestation of power, the power plays extremely important role. So, the role of the power to unprecedented extent, and power over forces of the nature, power over information, power of the people, power of the some groups over others can be seen. So, power has been embedded in empires, gangs, global corporates and so on. We have seen that power being exercised by force, compulsion, influence, propaganda, charisma, bureaucracy. I mean, these are the forms in which the power operates. I mean, few examples. So, power in its most general meaning is the ability to pursue and attain goals through mastery of one's environment, and gender stratification results from unequal distribution of the power between men and women. Let us understand Weber's concept, Max Weber's concept, which he contributed in 1969. He conceptualizes power as a form of legitimate authority derived from organizational position that people occupy. Power is connected to the authority, domination, exploitation, and is an entity that an individual or the group may possess. Power, to summarize, is a control by one person, group or the nation over the behavior and condition of the life of another. There is a good deal of the evidence linking power concern to the violence both at individual and collective level. Numerous studies suggest that when a concern for power is more frequent in speeches or diplomatic communication, the likelihood of the war also increases. On the other hand, it is observed that those cultures that do not take pleasure in domination, gender and other structural inequalities and the killing have a little differentiation of the sex roles, gender roles and no ideal of the brave aggressive masculinity. Whereas the vice versa is equally true, that the culture professing domination and killing have a strict gender differentiation in all spheres of life. For instance, rape is often explicit tactic of war, rape and power displayed. Few other human acts being across such a gory image of the rape. It is undoubtedly a gruesome act of violence and sexual assault instigated by one or more person against another human. In the earlier times, rape was considered as a victim precipitated phenomena, but later the psychiatrists and the psychological community concluded that rape is the result of the disordered sexual impulse in a certain group of men. Now, rape is a it has been studied as in the recent times as an act of violence and the politics and acting out of the power roles. A prime ingredient in the rape is the element of aggression, which is so deeply associated with the masculine traits. So in this light, it can be said that rape is not a deviant act, but an act of super conforming to the notion of masculinity. It fools brain in all the other desired masculine traits like force, strength, power, dominance, superiority, conquering, over, etc. So rape is now being seen as a violation of human rights also of an individual world over. There are more women victims of the rape because of the men holding more power than women, and thus there is an increased concern over women's right as a result of women's activism and women's movement. There is a greater emphasis on studying extent and locals of the sexual assault and their deepening consequence for the victim. As a result, social scientists have turned their attention towards understanding the dynamics of the rapist and their motives, the institutional and culture factors, and the factors affecting the victim and their reaction to the trauma. Now, let me cite here the one of the example when one is dealing with the manifestation of power. As I mentioned to you, the caste and the structural violence, the ways in which the manifestation of the patriarchy can be seen. This is a case study which I have taken. I would just to make you explain. This incident had happened in the Kailanji village of the Bhandara district of Maharashtra. Shows one of the brutal realities that reflects the ways in which caste, gender and violence operate in India. Bhayalan's family had to face caste-based violence. Dalit woman named Surekha, age 40, and her daughter Priyanka, her age was 17, were humiliated by the caste Hindus, which is again under the hierarchy, the dominant caste people. They were naked, gang-raped and lynched by some cruel groups who belonged to the upper strata of the caste society. Bhayalal's son Roshan and Sudhir, age 21 and 19, were also lynched by the same crowd. This incident was reported in one of the Marathi daily newspaper called Deshanati on 1st October 2006. It is analyzed that the caste Hindu women were also central to the violence against this Dalit woman. Caste Hindus also argued that Surekha had an illicit affair when with a man named Siddharth Gajbi, upper caste men and women, thus unleashed the violence in the base of the caste and the protection of the morality. This incident shows the ways in which the community question of the gender persistence of the patriarchy get articulated in the highly stratified society. Caste Hindus were unable to tolerate the assertive Dalit woman. Therefore, they started spreading rumors about the sexuality of the Dalit woman. Broadly, one can observe that how caste and gender are deployed to oppress certain marginalized section in the society. To conclude with this, that what I am trying to argue is this, let me say in the conclusion that thus we have learned from this lecture how sex gender binary is created, the debates by liberal to Marxist to socialist feminist, how patriarchy operates at several levels, how it organized in the public and private domain, and analyze the culture gender relationship, how it operates in the caste community, in the structural society, how bodies and the sexuality of the woman from the lower caste regulated by using the power and coercion, and then one would see the one can see the manifestation of patriarchy, how it operates at every level. So let me thank you. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you.